So our next presenter is a superstar, a 16-year-old superstar. And I had the pleasure of speaking to her father right before this morning got started. And I asked him because I was looking at her profile for the past 2 weeks and thinking, wow, that is pretty darn awesome. At 16 years old, right, she is a student from St. Francis High School, passionate about learning. Her constant curiosity and wonder have motivated her to pursue independent science, scientific research, which led her by invitation to be inducted into Sigma Chi Research Society. Now, as a father myself, I think to myself, how do we guide our students to do wonderful things like this, right? Because at 14, she also created Inspire 101. Now, Inspire 101 is a program that mentors middle schoolers in their science projects at 14. Imagine what you were doing at 14, right? So, ladies and gentlemen, it is my pleasure to bring up Anjini Karthik as our next awesome presenter.
When I was 5 years old, I was so excited. I was wearing my favorite winter sweater and playing with a balloon when I saw it stick to the wall. It was like magic. A few weeks later, I stood proudly in front of a bright yellow poster board at my school science fair, telling anyone who would listen about my sticky balloon. I was presenting what was literally titled My First Big Question. Questions beyond static electricity quickly became a central part of my life. When I was in fourth grade, my uncle bought a Prius, and everybody talked about how it gave 50 miles per gallon. I looked at it, and I just couldn't help but wonder, you know, why was that car so much better than my dad's Nissan Maxima? And then in middle school, I decided I was going to challenge my mom's cooking. I wasn't really a huge fan of her spicy Indian food. So instead I asked, were these spices even good for us, the way she claimed? Every year, I investigated a few of my big questions through the avenues of science fairs, starting with my school and eventually qualifying for local, state, and national level symposia. This constant questioning has brought me to today. I've been working at university labs for the last 5 years, and I'm currently developing a tool that can accurately detect flu infection within 20 minutes. And while I might open my research papers with something like introduction or purpose instead of the big question, I strive to be as curious, annoying, and questioning as I was with that balloon. But here's what I've noticed. So I volunteer with Science Buddies. It's an online forum where students of all grade levels can post for help with their science projects. Now, I get these kind of inquiries a lot, like urgent, need hypothesis, or must turn in proposal by tomorrow, please help. But this example is sort of an archetypical post. So where one day a student asked me to help him identify his independent, dependent, and control variables for his experiment. Now, I didn't want to give him the answer right away. So instead, I sort of like questioned him back, trying to have him like think himself or question himself into figuring it out. He was pretty irritated. But after a few back and forth posts, he had independently and correctly identified his variables, and this time he fully knew why. But this whole process just sort of got me thinking. I see posts like this all the time. Look, I need 25 similes and 25 metaphors from Huck Finn. Please tell me which chapter they're in. Now I look at this and I realize that Wiki Answers, Google Answers, Ask.com are filled with these kind of inquiries. And it just sort of made me realize how much we live in an answer-driven system. A system where the value of getting to it is higher than that of sparking an idea. Because we want the answers, and we want them now. But children are inherently curious. They're questioners. So recently, in light of my work, I asked a different sort of big question. How can I take my experiences through which I've come to love learning to other students so that we can maintain that adrenaline rush that comes from investigation? I don't have all the answers, but to start with, 2 years ago, I launched Inspire 101. It's an initiative where I work with middle schoolers and their science teachers on their science projects where students ask the questions. With Inspire 101, I've been both an educator and a student. In order to create a love of learning in students, we must first create a culture of questioning. And I believe that this can be accomplished in three main ways. First, start local. Understanding the mindset of the local community is essential to making an impact in it. To create this homegrown questioning mindset, we have to show our siblings, our parents, and our students right next to us that questioning in the home and in the classroom matters. Starting in an environment that we are already familiar with enables us to do this effectively. Next, look beyond the student. Now, that one's a little counterintuitive, but engaging teachers is vital. In my experience, students are automatically and immediately more enthusiastic when their teachers become involved. Conversely, when teachers come to endorse questioning, they not only legitimize this mindset, but also reach a much larger audience than any individual outside source could have. By giving teachers the resources, or sort of like the toolkit of questioning, they become the agents of empowerment, capable of reaching students wherever they may teach. Finally, always remember that kids are inherently curious. We don't have to go looking for our curiosity, only to remind ourselves that it's already there. This is something I learned from Manny. Manny is a seventh grader whom I worked with for a few months. As he investigated how various levels of music volume influence concentration, he eventually presented this project at Santa Clara County's Regional Science Fair last March. So Manny independently identified his big question, and he conducted his experiment with about 60 of his peers at Columbia Middle School in Sunnyvale. Remembering to adjust his independent variable, which was music volume, in many trials, as he kind of ran between desks and around desks to turn up the volume or turn it down. What I didn't know, actually, his teachers told me only when we were typing up the science fair board, was that Manny had trouble reading, had mild test anxiety, and was often in and out of special ed classes. And yet the question he posed was a first step to something that's being investigated by leading psychologists today. So questioning is universal. It pays no attention to resources or even to age. I like to sort of jokingly say, watch Jeopardy. And I mean this figuratively, although I highly recommend the show too. Because sometimes the answers are just right in front of us, but it's up to us to look at them and say what is, or better, what can be. So in that way then, asking questions are a part of us. And it's a part that transcends like science or English or history or any other such field. By channeling our questions, we accelerate our development as scientists, students, teachers, innovators, and lifelong learners. I am grateful to all my teachers and mentors for supporting me as I questioned. Without my educators, my big question might have been a solitary one. Now, I'd like to pose one new big question to all of you. With all the knowledge and the curiosity gathered here in this room alone, how much can we do to encourage ourselves and others not to answer, but to ask? Thank you.